Good evening, everybody. Good evening and welcome to Rogers Hall Admission here at Gordon-Conwell Theological Seminary. We are delighted to have all of you here this evening, and we are looking forward to a very eye-opening and informative roundtable discussion. Let's open our time together in prayer. Father, as we come before you this evening, we want to thank you for the truth of your word. We want to thank you that you have spoken through your word, that you have spoken your unchanging truth that stands over all human attempts to discern truth, stands over all cultural claims of truth. We thank you, Lord, that we have your word as an anchor by which we can come to know you, by which we can live our lives. I thank you, Lord, for these people gathered here together. I thank you for the way you have brought them to yourself, that you have made us your children and your worshipers. And I pray that this evening, as we attend to your word, as we attend to your servants of the past, I ask that you would grant us a discernment of your truth. I ask that you would grant us a worshipful spirit to focus upon you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. It is no secret, of course, that the values of our culture have been rapidly changing. And as they have been changing, Christianity and the lifestyle that Christianity affirms as honoring to God has come increasingly under suspicion and even under attack. And among the attacks are attacks that claim that true Christianity and the Bible don't actually say what Christians have traditionally said that they say. And so many Christians may be confused and may wonder what to make of such claims. And so it is our pleasure here to have this evening Dr. Roland Grams and Dr. Don Forston as we come together for this roundtable discussion sponsored by the Robert C. Cooley Center for the Study of Early Christianity. Dr. Grams is one of our professors at Gordon-Conwell. He is a New Testament professor here. He is freshly returned from a long ministry trip in South Africa. Dr. Forston is a professor at Reformed Theological Seminary, also here in Charlotte, and is certainly no stranger to Gordon-Conwell Charlotte because he also teaches regularly for us as well. So we thank you very much, Roland and Don, for your presence with us here this evening, and we look forward to what you have to tell us. Thank you.
Well, good to see all of you here, and I appreciate you spending the time tonight to be here. I've often wondered to myself, other than my long-term friendship with Dr. Grams and the wonderful opportunity to write a book with him, what in the world are you doing getting involved with this topic and this subject? As a church historian, this is not something I spend a lot of time thinking about and doing research upon. I want to begin tonight by just saying a little bit about why Roland and I, Dr. Grams, decided to launch out on this venture, as best I can calculate, almost 7 years ago when our conversation began. Because I think we owe it to you to give you an idea of our background. Both of us have mainline backgrounds, and so in that context in particular, of course, we have followed these discussions closely over many years. I can remember being in seminary, mainline seminary, in the late 70s, when these things just began to be discussed. And thinking to myself as a young person going into the ministry, is it conceivable that the church would actually change its traditional views on this subject in my lifetime. In fact, one of the books I remember reading many, many years ago is by a one of the Gordon-Conwell professors known in South Hamilton, Dr. Richard Lovelace. In fact, some of you in the room may have had a chance to study with Dr. Lovelace. And he wrote one of the early evangelical books on the topic, and it was something that I was keenly aware of and watching. In terms of why Dr. Grahams and I started on this journey together, a number of things really impacted our thinking and launched us on this period of our research and writing together. Number one is we observed the fierce ecclesiastical battle in the mainline churches. A number of them in recent decades have changed their views on the whole issue of homosexuality, of it being something that can be a legitimate within the Christian context. Certainly that was an issue, the proliferation of books on homosexuality. And as we began to do our research, it was really mind-boggling how much is out there. And I quickly learned the University of Chicago has published low many volumes written by gay scholars. And I had to buy and study a lot of those books in the midst of this. So it kind of opened up a new venue for me. But certainly within the context of not only mainline Protestantism, there have been books written by Orthodox scholars, Roman Catholics on this topic, and we tried to begin to look at all of these. Now, as a church historian, one of the things that really had been frustrating to me is the questioning of traditional Christianity in the midst of all of this. In fact, one of the questions that I always ask, I'm a history guy, and so I get asked this question all the time. Whenever the church deals with a controversy, well, what has the church said in the past is the question I get from students. And that's always a legitimate question to ask. But I found that Roman Catholics and the Orthodox intuitively always ask this question. Protestants rarely even care. And I thought to myself, something is really wrong with this picture. My memory tells me that Protestantism was a retrieval movement in the 16th century to go back to early Christianity, that we have forgotten who we are. And it appeared to me that this indeed was happening again. Also, one of our big frustrations is so many of the discussions in the books, particularly written in the Protestant realm, are all about human experience. And that's a legitimate issue and question to raise, but why is it there's so little attention to the text, either in the Old Testament or the New Testament, and my concern in church history? And so part of our focus in the book was to focus on the biblical text and also historical text. And a part of what really I think was a catalyst for us launching into this, in addition to from Rollins Field and biblical studies, seeing how shallow so many of the arguments have been presented over the years, just a series of bad arguments that typically contradict other scholars, no real consensus on these things, but yet in book after book is presented as though this is the newest and latest scholarly opinion, and why don't you all get on board with it? So that frustration ran really deep with us. And then, ever so frightening, persons who consider themselves evangelical beginning to present some of those same arguments. And from our perspective, arguments that had been debunked 30 years ago began to show up in books being published by evangelicals. So Ron and I, being good friends and over a cup of Starbucks, began the discussion 7 years ago and said, we need to do something about it. There's not a text that combines the work of a church historian and a New Testament scholar, a Bible guy, to look holistically at the text, not sharing our opinions and our experience, but what do the texts of our tradition actually say, biblical text and historical text. And so this is really where we headed as we began our work. Now, I've got to say this up front, and I know our time is limited tonight, and so I need to keep moving. But I know in this audience that you've already got a boatload of questions as you entered the doors tonight. But let me tell you what Rollin, in my book, addressed and what it did not address. And I like to put this under the rubric of three different audiences that the church must address as we approach the subject of homosexuality. Certainly secular gays and unbelievers, we are called, of course, to interact with them as we do any folks that have not come to Christ yet, to have a winsome witness before them. I think we'd all concur with that. Another audience is Christians who struggle with same-sex attraction. And yes, there's some in all of our churches. In fact, among married couples, one of the spouses may very well struggle with this. And there have been a lot of good books written on this topic. And it's encouraging to see the church getting on board with addressing this great pastoral need. And then finally, another audience that we've got to engage with now is what we might refer to as the gay Christian movement. And at that point, I think it's a matter of confronting false teaching. You know, we don't like to use the H word anymore, heresy, because it comes across as very intolerant in the 21st century. Well, that's a word the ancients used, but contrary to popular opinion, historic Christian orthodoxy does have some boundaries. It has had boundaries for two millennia, this is really the focus of our book. So as we began to work on our text, our book really does not address the first two audiences. Now, there are implications and things that are said along the way that may be applicable, but our real focus was on addressing what we perceived as to be the false gospel that is coming through in the gay Christian movement. And so 400 pages worth of engaging with all of this over a number of years and focusing on what do the text of the Christian tradition say? Old Testament, New Testament, church fathers, medieval theologians, the reformers of the 16th century, and ending my section in the historical portion on what does the Christian church say today? And let me just say this up front, just as context as we launch into this. One of the myths is perpetrated by the gay Christian movement in America, and I see it all the time. I saw it in print again just the other day, that the vast majority of the church is getting on board with the gay Christian ideology, and there's just a minority that are left that maintain the traditional views. That is completely false. If you look at some of the statistical studies, which has been done by the Pew Foundation on religion in America, if you take Roman Catholics, the Eastern Orthodox family of churches, Pentecostals, Evangelicals, and the historically black churches, we make up together, those groups, 90% of the church in the United States of America, for example, which leaves 10% to the historically mainline churches. This is the group that has been capitulating on the issue. But in terms of the evangelical, Catholic, and Orthodox churches, the vast majority of us very much are still committed to orthodoxy as it has always been understood. And that, again, is an important thing for us to look at. Well, the first chapter of the book is on the gay Christian movement, and again, just to say a few brief things about this, the gay rights movement, the Stonewall Riots in New York City back in the late 1960s is considered kind of the genesis of the modern gay rights movement. The Metropolitan Community Church was started just in the year previous. Previously, this was a former Pentecostal pastor who wanted to start a gay Christian church. And there are several hundred of the metropolitan community churches in the United States at this point, and some in different parts of the world. Many gay organizations, though, began to arise in some of the Protestant churches in America beginning in the 70s and the 80s, and were instrumental in moving a number of those denominations to the affirming position on homosexuality. And then what has come to the fore in recent years are these 20 and 30-somethings, young pro-gay evangelicals. And I want to just mention a couple of them. And one would be Justin Lee, who's the head of the Gay Christian Network, which he established in 2001. And his book, Torn, which was just published a few years ago, chronicles his experience, raised Southern Baptist, and a very moving tale of his own struggle with same-sex attraction and where he found so many of the traditional Christian views wanting. What he proceeds to do, it is very moving, and he would be certainly compassionate for his struggle. But he begins to build a straw man around the traditional view, and then he begins to bring in some of the revisionist scholarship. And what you begin to see in the book is that he found what he was looking for. Really, the direct statements of Scripture, the commands of God in the Old and New Testament, are not what's really important. What is important is the love that Jesus has shown us and the leading of the Holy Spirit in the contemporary church. And his big argument, and this is one of the big ones, is this is a matter of legitimate difference among Christians, and can't we overcome the divide? And you see the subtitle there, Rescuing the Gospel from the Gays versus Christians Debate. So Justin Lee would be very important. Matthew Vines, God and the Gay Christian. And you'll see the subtitle there, The Biblical Case in Support of Same-Sex Relationships. Now his book just came out a couple of years ago, reiterates a lot of the old scholarship that's been around since the 70s. The revisionist readings of the New Testament and Old Testament. And he is the originator of what's known as the Reformation Project. And his goal is to recruit a number of young people that will help change the minds of conservative evangelical churches on this issue. He sees this as the next frontier. The main line has already come over, and now we need to work on the evangelical churches. So, Lee and Vines get a lot of attention, but what people have forgotten is all about the two persons I'll call the gay Christian patriarchs, both of whom are Roman Catholic. John McNeil, a former Jesuit, he eventually was removed from the Jesuit order, but wrote one of the earliest pro-gay books, The Church and the Homosexual, in 1976. Originally was officially published by the Roman Catholic Church, but that was withdrawn very shortly. I wish I had more time to talk about him. He clearly is the godfather of the movement. His book is in its fourth edition, A Festschrift in His Honor, was recently published. And he is Exhibit A of part of our argument that the gay Christian movement and the secular gay movement, there's really no distinction. If you read what John McNeil, and he is very radical about this, and he really is the father of the gay Christian movement. He sees the evolution of the heightened awareness of the homosexual of lifestyle and homosexuality is the movement of God, the Holy Spirit in history, that homosexuality is now the direction toward which culture is going. This is all a part of God's plan. And there's so many other things I wish I had time to tell you that would shock you, but you'll just have to look at his book or some of the other things that he has written. But for my purposes as a church history guy, the individual that I really wanted to focus on was a man by the name of John Boswell. Now, his particular book was written in 1980. You'll see the title there, Christianity, Social Tolerance, and Homosexuality, Gay People in Western Europe from the Beginnings of the Christian Era to the 14th Century. Now, just a year ago, the 35th anniversary edition of his book has been published. The old book that has been debunked by patristic scholars and medieval experts over the decades, but yet it continues to be in print. And Boswell's attempt was to basically assert, and I'm going to give you the statement of his thesis here in a moment, that early Christianity and parts of the Middle Ages were really not all that opposed to homosexuality. Now, he's Roman Catholic. Remember I said he intuitively knew, if I'm going to change the mind of the church, I have got to prove, I must demonstrate that there's evidence in the history of the church about this. Because otherwise, it'll never fly. It'll never go. We do not have the right to now reinterpret the Bible in a way that the church has never understood it in the past. And Roman Catholics just think that way. And maybe we Protestants ought to consider those things a little bit more ourselves. Now, the other book that he wrote in 1994, Same-Sex Unions, this is where he argues for the presence of the blessing of gay unions in the medieval period. And again, I'm sorry I don't have time to unpack that. Again, the scholars kind of hammered him on this. But you'll see the images of two martyrs from the early church, the 4th century, Sergei and Bacchus, who are considered paired saints. And this is an image in a monastery that he purports to suggest that they had some kind of same-sex union, which, you know, as a church history guy and reading all about the martyrs, to call these Christian soldiers that died for Christ homosexuals is very offensive when there's no evidence for this at all. But this was the part of the thesis of the book in many other ways. Well, here's the Boswell thesis. You know, if you're a history person, you know that you've really arrived when they name a thesis after you. So if you ever read the Forston thesis, you'll know that I have become a top-tier scholar. Well, about 10 years ago, a book was published entitled The Boswell Thesis. And it had contributors from gay scholars from around the country. Now, re-engaging 25 years later, with the work of John Boswell. Well, here's a passage from his book, which is typically understood to contain the essence of the Boswell thesis. And let me just read it and you can follow along. The early Christian church does not appear to have opposed homosexual behavior per se. The most influential Christian literature was moot on the issue. No prominent writers seem to have considered homosexual attraction unnatural, and those who objected to physical expression of homosexual feelings generally did so on the basis of considerations unrelated to the teaching of Jesus or his early followers. Hostility to gay people and their sexuality became noticeable in the West during the period of the dissolution of the Roman state. Neither Christian society nor Christian theology as a whole evidenced or supported any particular hostility to homosexuality, but both reflected and in the end retained positions adopted by some governments and theologians which could be used to derogate homosexual acts. So the first sentence there, the early Christian church does not appear to have opposed homosexuality per se. What I would like to do in the few short minutes I've got left here is to give you some evidence from the patristic era in terms of where the early church was on these things. And, of course, our book is full of hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of texts. This is the focus of what our book was about, and so I would be remiss if I didn't give you a little evidence from our work to show where the Boswell thesis has been proven to be completely false. And when I conclude, I want to give you a reference from a secular gay scholar in his comments on the Boswell thesis, which I think you'll find incredibly enlightening. All right, church history and homosexuality. There are a lot of different kinds of literature we can look at, early books of order, council meetings of bishops, individual writings. I want to begin with a couple of passages out of one of the early Christian books of order, if you would, the Constitutions of the Holy Apostles, and I want to highlight what they had to say about Christian marriage. And of course, that is the focal point of our discussion in our culture today, ever since the Obergefell decision. It's hard to believe it's not much longer than a year ago. Isn't that hard to believe? One person decided that for an entire nation. I had a lawyer look me in the eye and say that one time. He said, yeah, the decision was 5-4. My, how things have changed. All right, late 4th century. And this is a text which is considered by most scholars to be evidence of Christian perspectives at this point in time. Notice what they said about Christian marriage. We believe that lawful marriage and the begetting of children is honorable and undefiled, for the difference of sexes was formed in Adam and Eve for the increase of mankind. We acknowledge with us a soul that is incorporeal and immortal, not corruptible as bodies are, but immortal. As being rational and free, we abhor all unlawful mixtures. And you're going to see their definition of that on the next slide. And that which is practiced by some against nature as wicked and impious. Here's another selection. But we do not say so of that mixture that is contrary to nature, or of any unlawful practice, for such are an enmity to God, for the sin of Sodom is contrary to nature, as is also that which brute beasts. For the practices of one sort attempt the dissolution of the world and endeavor to make the natural course of things to change for one that is unnatural. These things are forbidden by the laws. For thus say the oracles, thou shalt not lie with mankind as with womankind, for such a one is accursed, and you shall stone them with stones. They have wrought abominations. These things the laws have forbidden, but they have honored marriage and have called it blessed, since God has blessed it, who joined male and female together. The wise Solomon somewhere says a wife is suited to her husband by the Lord. One of the interesting points that Boswell made in his book is he argued that the old Levitical holiness code in the Old Testament, which is very explicit about a man shall not lay with a man, that was basically considered on the level of a man lying with a beast, and same thing for women, that this really carried no weight in the early church. But what you do find in the actual text, they actually cited it all the time. Because why? We forget, what, particularly in the early years, what was the Bible of early Christianity? It was the Old Testament. As the New Testament was being formed and the canon collected and put together. All right, I'm going to run through just a few of these for a few moments, and then I'll turn it over to Roland here. One of the oldest extra canonical texts we've got, the Didache, raises the issue of pederasty. That is the corrupter of boys or the abuse of boys, which was rampant in the Greco-Roman culture in some corners. And very clearly, the direction in the Didache, that this is unacceptable for Christians. Tertullian's Apology, he's arguing for the toleration of Christians in the empire. This very brilliant lawyer from Carthage who is converted has left us many wonderful texts from his pen. He's arguing for Christianity, and he makes this observation. But if we challenge you, he's talking about pagans, to the comparison in the virtue of chastity, I turn to part of the sentence passed by the Athenians against Socrates, who is pronounced a corrupter of youth. The Christian confines himself to the female sex. Hippolytus, a bishop of Rome. This one is most interesting. One of the major arguments that you find, particularly among the younger evangelicals that are pushing the gay agenda, is, well, we really can discount almost everything written in the Bible about homosexuality because the ancients knew nothing about homosexual orientation. That's nonsense. They weren't stupid people. They observed that there are men that are inclined toward affections to men and women to women. They observed it, they talked about it. And one of the ancient explanations was astrology. In this particular text, Hippolytus is attacking astrology, and he's talking about how those that are born under Sagittarius, you'll notice the highlight the portion, are given to unnatural lust. If the stars have a power to give a personal inclinations and characteristics. So he's arguing against this, but it's evidence that indeed pagans themselves have this sense. That, of course, course, we know that there are certain people that are inclined toward this. There's a text by St. Cyprian, one of the martyrs, just talks about what he observed during his day. You'll notice in the highlighted portion, men with frenzied lust rushing upon men, his observation in the middle of the third century. St. Basil, one of the great Cappadocian fathers, very important contribution to the doctrine of the Trinity. And the reason this text is important is he talks about those that are willing to confess their sin and receive compassion and forgiveness in the church. The other myth that is perpetrated, I can't believe some of the stuff that goes in print. Just because somebody has a PhD after their name and puts something in print doesn't necessarily mean it's true. You hear discussions about how many hundreds, sometimes thousands of homosexuals that the church put to death. False, again. Very rarely did it ever happen there. And where it could legally be a capital offense, often it was not, particularly in the time of the Christian Empire and into the Middle Ages. And what you do find is not this sense that, you know, the church was bent on just moving all the those that practice homosexuality to church. No, they were all about encouraging people to confess their sin and come back into the fellowship of the church. And they deserve your compassion, as Basil says here. Let me just move on a moment to get a few others here. That other text was from Augustine in the Confessions. St. John Chrysostom, much beloved by the Reformers later on, in his commentary on the Book of Romans, some of his sermons, he says, yet a more disgraceful thing than these it is when even the women seek after these intercourses who ought to have more sense of shame than the men. City of God also mentions lesbian practice. It is true, most of the discussions are all about male practice and not female practice, but it does show up on a few occasions. Now, St. John Chrysostom was known for being very direct, and he does, in this particular text, talk about how things are all turned upside down and that this is diabolical. In fact, this theme shows up in a number of the fathers, and even Luther talked about homosexuality being inspired by the devil. And they just had a sense that this was from the kingdom of darkness. And at the end of this text, he says, some of you, if you scoff at hearing of hell and believe not that fire, remember Sodom. Well, I don't have time to go much into medieval legal codes. But what I do want to just say a couple of words, and then I'm going to conclude here, about a whole body of literature known as the medieval penitentials. And this was brand new research for me. I had just never spent any time in the penitentials. And basically these were pastoral guides for priests in the Middle Ages. They began in Ireland, spread to Anglo-Saxon England, then back over to the continent. And these collection of texts to give local pastors, if you would, guidance. How do you deal with people that are struggling with particular sins? And how are we going to exercise discipline and care for them and come up with a process whereby they can amend their lives and fully fellowship with the life of the church? This is very encouraging to me. And what you find is a keen pastoral heart among these priests in the Middle Ages. Number one, you see that homosexuality was throughout Europe. It's always been with us. You know, it begins to show up in Genesis. What we're experiencing now in our culture is no different. Again, as Richard Lovelace said, the problem is it had all gone underground, and now it's back out in the open again. That's the only difference. And I think it's really true. But you see there, big heart for people, a desire to care for people. They were very sensitive to the unique situation of the different individuals. And again, you'll just have to get the book and read some of that for yourselves or look some of that up. All right, I'm going to get to my final slide here. I knew I wouldn't come close to getting through this stuff. That's always the way it is. History guys can talk forever. All right, this is where I wanted to go. Obviously, the balance of justice indicates very clearly where the weight of evidence is. Now, I've just given you a little bit. I'm serious. There are hundreds and hundreds of citations. You can look it up in the book. You can go look it in the primary sources. And what you find there is that the score is 100 to nothing. Hear that? I'm not kidding. Contrary to what Dr. Boswell said. I'm going to give you that quote I told you about from a gay scholar. John Lawrence in 1981 wrote this. I'm just going to be quiet and let you read it so it can sink in. Commenting on the Boswell thesis. I'd argue this is exactly on target. And it took someone out the church, outside of the church, to very clearly articulate what scholars all knew. And the book seems very impressive. It's a big boy of about 400 pages. Often, most of the pages, half of them, are long Latin citations. So it came across as very impressive. The media hailed it as the new breakthrough. You can be Christian and practice homosexuality. The church has messed up on this for 2,000 years. And so Boswell puts this on the table. The scholars have debunked it long ago. It continues to be in print. And by Joe, it still shows up in the footnotes of all these books that keep getting published. But don't buy it. It's not true. All right, Roland. I'm going to turn it over to you, friend. Let's see, we can get out of this and we'll get yours up. There you go.
Okay, thanks. Well, thanks to all for coming out for a night on a topic like this, my goodness. And we're happy to be able to take this book out of the closet and I wanted to say a few things in general about the book and then zero in on some of the argument. First of all, as Don was talking about at the beginning, one of our concerns was that the literature that we were reading on this topic was woefully inadequate in terms of dealing with primary sources. Just yesterday, I was looking at some more material, Matthew Vines, for example, James Bronson, scholars that would be, well, at least Bronson would be considered a scholar, people who sound scholarly to average people, but they're not engaging the primary texts. And if the issue is texts, you've got to deal with texts. You can't cite 20th century scholars who say something about texts and not cite the texts and talk about them. So a lot of this book has to do with citing the texts. And whatever argument you want to make, you've got to deal with those texts. And this is a resource for people who want to see what the texts say. That's one thing we wanted to do. The other thing we did was we started with church history, and then we moved to biblical studies. The purpose of doing that, just as tonight, was to say, this is what the church has taught. And then the second part of the book is, oh my goodness, did we get it wrong? Right? And that has been an argument people have tried to use on comparing it to the issue of slavery or the issue of women in the church. Which, right at the end, Don does deal with those two other issues briefly, but the same question might be raised. Did we get it wrong? I mean, after all, we're Protestants. We can ask that question. And so then we turn to look at the biblical material. So we look at the biblical texts themselves that deal with homosexuality, and then we look at them in their context. So that means looking at the ancient Near East, the ancient Near Eastern literature for the Old Testament, and the Greco-Roman literature for the New Testament. And so we read the texts in their contexts, and you'll see some of that in my presentation shortly. I also wanted in my section to engage, as Don dealt with Boswell's thesis and his church history side, which also is irrelevant for my side of the book, I wanted to address primarily those scholars who are interpreting the text differently from historic orthodoxy. So you don't find a lot in my footnotes that are saying, and see, look, someone agrees with me. I'm not trying to pad my footnotes to make that argument. Rather, I'm arguing with people who take the opposite position a lot. And then finally, I want to say that our book ends with a challenge. We look at the texts and say, this is what they said. Can you possibly disagree? But then we say, so therefore the issue is biblical authority. And that's really where this issue is. In other words, you will often hear the argument made that we can't come to an agreement on what the texts say. There's just so much confusion out there. We don't really know what the Bible was saying on this issue. That was recently put forward by an Anglican diocese in South Africa to the synod that met just a month ago. And the first argument they made was, we don't know what the text says, so we have to move from the Bible to talk about other things. Well, we do know what the Bible said, and it's very clear, and this is part of our argument. But we end with the challenge then of, if that's the case, then the real question is biblical authority. And you'll notice that all the mainline denominations that are arguing in favor of homosexuality also have jettisoned the view that the Bible is the authoritative word of God. Interesting, right? Okay, well, let me move on then. And I want to give you a taste of the kind of argument that we have in the book. Now, I don't want to give you exactly what I have done in the book. There's some of the same quotes are here, but I've arranged it a little differently so that the lecture's a bit different from the book. But this is how the arguments kind of go. In the 1980s, a key argument turning around the issue for churches on homosexuality, particularly in mainline denominations, was that antiquity knew no notion of homosexual orientation. This is the old evolutionary argument. My, how we know so much more than those ancients did. And usually those arguments have to do with how little people know about the ancient world rather than the other way around. Two scholars, as an example, might be listed. And I remember reading Robin Scrogg's book, Presbyterian Scholar, New Testament Scholar, in the 1980s. And his book actually looked scholarly. He did engage primary texts, and he did the stuff that a biblical scholar is expected to do. But it was a thin book, and he really didn't engage the text very much. In fact, he grossly got it wrong. He said, pederasty, that is an adult male having sexual relationships really with a teenage boy. Pederasty was the only model for homosexuality in existence in the world of Paul's time. And at the risk of seeming endlessly repetitive, I close with the observation that Paul thinks of pederasty and perhaps the most degraded forms of it when he is attacking homosexuality. And then he also suggested that maybe there's a problem with pederasty from a Christian perspective because there wasn't mutuality, an adult male and a teenage boy. Victor Paul Furnish, a Methodist, another New Testament scholar, someone I respected very highly for his work on Paul's ethics, nevertheless elsewhere said this, the concepts homosexual and homosexuality were unknown in Paul's day. These terms, like heterosexual, heterosexuality, bisexual, and bisexuality, presuppose an understanding of human sexuality that was possible only with the advent of modern psychology and sociological analysis. The ancient writers were operating without the vaguest idea of what we have learned to call sexual orientation. That's the 1980s. Now notice two mainline denominations that had been dealing with the issue. One has affirmed homosexuality in every level, and the other one is currently hotly debating the issue, the Methodists. So this idea from the 1980s is still around today. Although Vines isn't a scholar, he's trying to engage scholarly work and has written a very popular book on the subject. Matthew Vines argued in 2015 that no Christian prior to the 20th century ever specifically prescribed lifelong celibacy for gay Christians because same-sex orientation was not acknowledged by Christians until the 20th century. Very popular idea. It is so wrong. I mean, it is so obviously wrong. So we should ask then the questions, does Scripture, particularly Paul, address only some particular form of homosexuality, like pederasty or homosexual prostitution, or maybe homosexual prostitution in the temples, or unclean sex, or sexual excess, that's Vine's argument, obsessions, orgies, multiple partners, outside committed unions, is that really the issue? And then we might ask, is sexual orientation a modern discovery unknown in antiquity? Or were there various forms and understandings of homosexuality in antiquity? And then did antiquity have examples of lifelong, committed, loving, monogamous homosexual unions and even marriages? Oh, they didn't know that back then, but we know it now. And it's a different thing. Paul was talking about something different, goes the argument. It's simply a matter of not knowing the primary texts. First of all, we can say several things about observations and views on same-sex orientation in the Greco-Roman world. Firstly, there's this quote from the late first century by Marshall suggests that he's aware of people coming of age and discovering certain sexual orientations. He says, Polytemus is hurrying to the girls. Hymnus doesn't like admitting that he's a boy. Secundus has buttocks acorn-sated. You can guess what that means. And Didymus is effeminate. The word mollus, it means soft in Latin, and it's related to a word Paul uses in 1 Corinthians 6:9, malakos, but doesn't want to be. Amphion could have been born a girl. Avitus, I would rather have their whims and haughtiness and querulous disdains than five times 200,000 sesterces of dowry in a marriage. Also, we find romantic love. Pederasty is different from, what's the other word? When an adult has sex with children.
Pedophilia,
thank you. Another P word. I am still on jet lag. It's different in this regard. It was understood in a romantic relationship between the adult and the youth, rather than an abusive relationship. And the uncontrollable drive of one's sexual desires in pederasty and the chosen object of desire suggests something of orientation, I would argue. So Virgil, for example, has this saying, "Cruel Alexis, heed you not my songs?" You know, he's in love with the kid. "Have you no pity? You drive me to my death, beauteous boy." Okay, so that would be another example of an understanding of orientation. Thirdly, there's medical discussion around this. Galen from the second century AD, but also Aristotle on the next slide. Galen's theory can be presented this way, his very simplistic understanding of psychophysiology, that there are different complexions that people have that relate to their personalities, their orientations and dispositions. And the third of these was the phlegmatic person, associated with cold and wet and the primary element of water, pale and fat people, soft. This included eunuchs, this included women, this included children, but it was also a way of talking about homosexuals who are regularly referred to as soft. And then Aristotle says, shrill, soft, broken tones mark the speech of the pathic, for such a voice is found in women and it's congruous with the pathic's nature. See the word nature there. It's part of a disposition. It's not just a one-off act. It's not, I'll try this for a bit. It's, this is my whole characteristic. In other words, an orientation. Astrology was mentioned by Don from a church father. Here's one of the primary sources. Ptolemaeus, in his Tetrabiblos, talks about which planets have to be in which position when a child is born to create a certain sexual orientation. And so you have options of if the Mars, the god of war, and Venus, the god of love, are in certain positions in the sky, that will lead to certain kinds of dispositions people have. If either one of them or both is made masculine, the males become addicted to natural sexual intercourse. And the Greek there is kataphusin. But then later he says, the females born in that time, though, are going to have unnatural congresses. And he uses the word phrase paraphusin, which is actually the exact phrase Paul uses in Romans chapter 1, verse 26, when he's talking about lesbianism. There have been all kinds of weird ideas about what Paul means by natural and unnatural. But Paul was actually using standard language that can be documented in numerous texts to refer to unnatural sexual relations, that is, homosexuality. The women with whom they are on such terms as their lawful wives, and I want to talk about the idea of homosexual marriage as well. So this would be one of the texts. Then there's speculation about orientation from philosophy and mythology. Plato has a very famous piece called The Symposium, in which a myth is presented, and the myth talks about creation in terms of three types of people that were created. He says, each of us then is but a tally of a man, since everyone shows like a flatfish the traces of having been sliced in two, and each is ever searching for the tally that will fit him. Coming together. Well, you can come together in three options: a man and a woman orientation, a woman and a woman orientation, and a man and a man orientation. This is an argument for orientation from a myth in the 5th century BC or earlier. Artistic temperament. There's a much longer passage, but I can't refer to all of it here. But Aristophanes, from the classical Greek period, has a work called Women of the Thesmophoria and indicates this. Besides, it is bad taste for a poet to be coarse and hairy, in other words, masculine. Look at the famous Ibicus, who handled music so well. They wore headbands and found pleasure in the lascivious and dances of Iona. And have you not heard what a dandy Phrynichus was and how careful in his dress? For this reason, his pieces were also beautiful, for the works of a poet are copied from himself. Personality, orientation, and artistic temperament. Seventh, unrestrained natural sexual desire becomes unnatural desire. Now, Vine's argument, by the way, is that all Paul's talking about is unrestrained sexual desire. But what Paul is really talking about is how unrestrained desire can lead to unnatural desire. Paul is talking about unnatural desire. And so he's got it quite wrong in his basic thesis that you can get an affirmation of homosexuality from Scripture. Philo, a Jew of the first century, talks about those people who are have become accustomed to be treated like women, and he uses the word malakos, that soft word that you find in 1 Corinthians 6:9 here. Plutarch talks about not even nature, he says, with law for her ally, can keep within bounds the unchastened vice of your hearts, but as though swept by the current of their lusts beyond the barrier at many points, men do such deeds as wantonly outrage nature, upset her order, and confuse her distinctions. So the relationship between an unrestrained sexual desire becoming a natural desire, a progression. Then there's the idea of this soft man that I've been talking about from 1 Corinthians 6:9. The question it relates, I would argue, to an idea of orientation, whether it's natural or acquired. It is one's orientation. What does Paul mean by soft men here? This is my translation. I'm sorry I didn't catch the Greek there, for those of you who know Greek in the font. But my translation would be say, nor adulterers, nor soft men, nor homosexuals. Now here are ways in which this is translated in various English translations. The RSV combines those two words, for example, just for nor sexual perverts. Well, what does that mean? The NIV says male prostitutes, nor homosexual offenders. So it makes the issue more prostitution. NIV does, and that's a hopeless translation. The NRSV also says male prostitutes and sodomites, and the ESV combines them and says, nor men who practice homosexuality. The two words are soft men and homosexuals. The actual term is one Paul makes up, which we'll talk about later. Let me move on then to this slide. Aristotle, in his Nicomachean Ethics, talks about the relationship between luxury and weakness, and therefore sexual orientation. He talks about those who are living a soft life, malakos, or luxurious life, right? The kind who go to too many Starbucks and so forth. Their life is easy. And such a man lets his cloak trail on the ground to escape the fatigue and trouble of lifting it, and so forth. Then he says, due to some innate tendency or to disease, instances of the former being hereditary effeminacy of the royal family of Scythia, and the inferior endurance of the female sex as compared with the male. So he's relating this characteristic of weakness to this kind of orientation, luxury to this kind of weak orientation in the male. So this is one meaning of malakos. Clement of Alexandria talks about luxury as well, and one who is infected with this disease of effeminacy, and he talks about men who shave themselves smooth. Notice the relationship between smooth and soft, and their effeminates. And Philo gives us an idea that then the word malakos can really mean womanly, and some of our English translations do translate the word as effeminate. They were overcome by violent desire, and so by degrees the men became accustomed to be treated like women, we read earlier. Then we have Epictetus, a Stoic from the first century, says, well, what other appellations have you? Are you a man or a woman? A man? Then adorn yourself as a man, not as a woman. A woman is naturally smooth and delicate, and if hairy, is a monster and shown among the monsters of Rome. Paul's dealing with this issue in 1 Corinthians 11, 2 through 16. Of what have you to accuse your nature, sir, that it is made you a man? There is also the idea with this softness in the culture related to passive sexual partners, as women are passive. Ptolemy, again, says the men, on the contrary, become effeminate, malakoi, and unsound with respect to natural, kataphusin, congresses and the functions of women, and are dealt with as pathics, the person in a homosexual relationship who is passive, though privately and secretly. And then also Juvenal talks about the tight homosexual community. Great is the concord among soft men, he says, the males, he's speaking Latin. Now, soft males, I'm also going to have to pay attention to skipping a few things. So let me skip that particular text.
Let's see what time it is.
Okay.
What does it say?
I conveniently forgot my watch when I... Okay, I do need to bring this to a close. Let me highlight the categories and spend less time in the text. But I hope you see the importance of presenting the texts as well as catching which word is used in the Latin or the Greek in the case of the New Testament side and the Greco-Roman work, because these terms are terms Paul uses. Now, this slide is actually showing you that there's a vast variety of words that are used for homosexuality. Remember, Ferner said we didn't even know what that was. Well, they had more words than we do to describe different types of things. Malakos being one of them. Then there were also brides. Juvenal talks about this, and I wanted to, yes, okay. I have a number of slides here where I look at same-sex marriage, since this has become an issue in the 2000s in our culture. Let me just summarize it by saying that there are quite a number of references to same-sex marriage in the Greco-Roman world. Now, why is that important? It's important because this means that Paul knew about these things. You can't say, oh, Paul didn't know about loving, lifelong, long-term, caring homosexual marriage. And so he must have been talking about some kind of abusive relationship or some sort of just bisexuality or some prostitution or something to do with the temple and all of these other suggestions that have been made. Paul knew about the variety. Paul knew of the options. Paul even knew about homosexual marriage, as did the early church. And so it's a matter of reading the texts and the primary texts in order to understand how much Paul would have understood. Whereas scholars in the 20th and 21st century have been saying, oh, Paul didn't know about this. We're so much more enlightened than that culture that day was. All right. The other term used in 1 Corinthians 6:9, alongside of soft man, is a term Paul coins with two Greek words stuck together. Like you can do that in German, you can do that in Greek. And so he uses the word men and the word for bed. And so I would say these are men-bedders, which is best translated as homosexuals. And where does he get this word from? It's actually right there, despite the font again. Don't know how that... maybe it's because you don't have my fonts. Okay, sorry. Arsenikoitai is... The two words are found side by side in the Holiness Code in Leviticus 20, verse 13. And texts didn't have spaces between words. It's not that Paul wouldn't have understood that there were spaces there, but he obviously saw it there, and he's referring to this text. And so he uses that. This is a term we only find in Christian literature from the time of Paul on. So probably Paul's the one who coined the term, and it was used because they're referring back to Paul's teaching on this in 1 Corinthians 6:9 and in 1 Timothy 1:10. Okay. I think I will leave it there because of the time. It's time.
Let's do it.
Yeah. We wanted to stop about now, right? Don? Stop about now so that we can have time of questions and answers. So let me bring that then to a conclusion. As I have been arguing, we have primary texts that talk about a variety of types of homosexuality, both male and female. We have a broad understanding of this, such that we cannot say with someone like Scroggs that basically the model that they would have had for reading Paul would have been pederasty. There's just a whole variety of understanding, including homosexual marriage. And I didn't go through a lot of slides on the homosexual marriage issue. We've also seen, I think, I have argued well enough, that antiquity is trying to figure out why people are oriented this way. Now, what we didn't go over here, and we can talk about it if you want to, but there were different views. Some were saying people were born that way, and others are saying they were socialized that way. Plato, for example, argues that this practice of pederasty came to Greece because of the gymnasium, men exercising in the nude. And that along with the gymnasium came this practice of pederasty. And then other ancient scholars talk about, oh, well, that culture practices that, but this culture doesn't. And so they had an idea of difference. And therefore, the argument from that group was, it's a matter of socialization. Whereas the other passages that I presented to you tonight talked about it more as an orientation that has to do probably with someone's actual disposition. Now, one thing I want to conclude then with is my last slide. That's done there. Almost last slide. Paul would say, yes, there is such a thing as homosexual orientation. But his understanding would be, but we weren't made that way. But this is a result of the fall. And secondly, he says, and it's part of the gospel to say that God can transform you. So, for example, something often missed in reading Romans is the relationship between Romans 1:28 and Romans 12:2. Romans 1:28 says, and following the description of lesbians and homosexuals, 1:28 says, and since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased noose, mind, and to things that should not be done. And then he presents the gospel. And then he gets to chapter 12, and he says, therefore, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your nousis, of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. This isn't a passage to tell the youth that God has a plan for your life. This is a passage that's undoing what was argued in chapter 1, saying people lost the ability to know what's right and wrong ethically. God gave them over to that. But now, in light of the transforming gospel, you can know what God's good and acceptable and perfect will is. Be transformed by the renewing of your minds. And Ephesians says something similar. I stuck that in there because it's often forgotten. Ephesians 4:17, and then ending with verse 24 to look at that. So let's stop there.
Thank you very much, Dr. Forston and Dr. Graham, for this very clear presentation. One of the things that I'm sure you noticed was how many slides they flipped through without reading them and without referring to them. So you can see that even on the slide presentations, they had far more evidence than what they actually talked about. And of course, the book itself presents far more evidence than what was on all of the slides. So let me encourage you, if you would like to dig into this issue more deeply after we finish this evening, to buy one of the copies of the book. The book is on sale right outside the door here. I think they would be willing even to sign your copy for you after you buy it, if you'd like to ask them to do so. In the meantime, we would like to give you an opportunity to ask questions. And in order for everybody to be able to hear the questions, and in order for the questions to be heard clearly on the recording that we're making, we'd like to ask you to come to the microphone, which is in the center aisle there, and ask questions from there. Dr. Fortson or Dr. Grams or both will be happy to address those questions. So please do forward if you have a question, and we'll spend some time answering questions now.
I had a conversation with somebody and they brought this up and I tried to defend it. They shot me down, but they said, well, didn't you know that Paul was a homosexual? That's his secret sin that he was talking about, tried to talk about, they wouldn't listen. The sin he was talking about that said, my thorn in the flesh. I'm sure you're familiar with that, but any advice you could give on that would be helpful.
Hello? No, the question was, is Paul's reference to a thorn in the flesh in 2 Corinthians 12 a reference to his struggling with homosexuality? Really a fascinatingly deep argument. It would be connected to the suggestion that Paul was single in connecting it to 1 Corinthians 7, where he says he has the gift of celibacy, but he doesn't use those words. And then also 1 Corinthians 9 about his traveling on his own. So though it would be an attempt to speculate on the basis of Paul. It's as strong an argument as my arguing that Paul's real problem was a back injury that affected his right leg, and he walks with a cane now. there's nothing to say. It's a speculation.
Richard Lovelace, in his conversation on this topic, always sort of framed it in the context of, okay, so what's God's Spirit doing in all of this? And I've often wondered, you know, for 40 years, this has been the issue that has dominated the Presbyterian Church during my ministry within it. So I keep asking myself, so what was God doing in this particular time with this particular debate taking place? Do you have any insight into that? On the one hand, what is the Holy Spirit about allowing this to come up in this time and place? Secondly, a question, do you think evangelical scholars bear any responsibility for having been essentially absent from this debate as it took place within particularly the mainline churches? To my recollection, only Richard Lovelace and Don Williams engaged in this at the denominational level. I never saw another theologian or biblical scholar at any of the general assemblies that I attended offering any kind of input or counter argument. So do we bear maybe some responsibility here?
I think your first question is probably be over on my side in terms of the big picture of history. Let me see if I can frame this in terms of a great theologian that has arguably had perhaps the largest imprint on the history of Christianity, and that's St. Augustine and his view of history, which he articulated in the famous City of God. He talked about how civilizations rise and fall. If you may remember, he talked about the history being in terms of the days of creation with the morning and evenings as he looked at the fall of Rome in his own lifetime, and he reminded the church of his day, the Christian society, the Christian Rome, which now was being destroyed by the Goths and the Vandals, is that we look for no continuing city here. There's only one eternal city, and that these the wickedness, you know, in cultures as they rise and fall seems to ebb and flow throughout history. And we just happen to be following the natural course, unfortunately, since the fall in what we're seeing happening in the West. Now, that's very disconcerting to say that. But you've got to remember, for Christians that lived in the late 4th and early 5th century, Rome was still the eternal city. I mean, they were completely devastated. And what St. Augustine had to do when the culture that they knew, had become a Christian culture, was destroyed for all practical purposes. Jesus told you this was going to happen. Because of the fall, because of wickedness, nations will rise and fall. The wheat and the tares will grow together. Good and evil will grow together until the very end when Jesus comes again. So I, looking at it, Trevor, from that perspective, I just see this, you know, time in which we live, as horrific as it is, particularly those of us that are older and remember a time when it didn't look quite like that in American culture, that we have forgotten the big picture of what history tells us about nations and their wickedness and their corruption. And when, even with Christian influence, which was happening in the late antiquity in the Roman Empire, but yet they were overcome, and God's hand there was heavy upon them. So I think that vision is very important. The other thing I would say, because I don't want to go on too much about this, sometimes there has been a tendency to talk about the Holy Spirit work in our midst as though the Holy Spirit may do something other than what he has told us in his word. And I think it's important for us always to remember that the Holy Spirit never contradicts himself. He's already told us what his perspective is on the ethical standards that are expected among his people. And that's part of what I saw in the historical section. In this is where we've come full circle. Now, in a post-Christian culture in America, we talk about it all the time, but it's so real. We're basically experiencing what the Christians of the early centuries did. So take heart. It's happened again. It will likely happen again if the Lord tarries. But our job is to be those that are obedient to the revealed Word of God. And the early church leaders just had to, these pagan converts, continue to hammer to them sexual faithfulness. Only the woman. No more prostitutes. No more gay lovers. And there was one quote Roland didn't get to on there by a guy, a Harvard scholar named Kyle Harper, who just talked about how his interpretation of what Christianity did the Roman world is basically took the notion of shame and transformed it into the notion of sin. And this is what was new about Christianity, is that everything other outside of male-female marriage and the conjugal relationship there is sin in the sight of Almighty God. That was a new idea to them. And when Christianity spread to the pagan populations of Europe, had to do it again in the Middle Ages. We've got to teach the people again a biblical sexual ethic. And this is why looking at, you know, the ancient sources is just so important, because nothing ever changes. Solomon told us, we don't believe it, but it's really true. And homosexuality has been as prevalent in every age since the book of Genesis as it is today. It's just out in the open more. It's always been there. This is why it's preposterous to suggest Christianity should now awaken and change our perspective because of a new circumstance. Nothing has changed at all. It's always been the clarion call for Christians to live in a distinct way, separate from the culture in which they live.
I want to pick up on the issue of culture. Read Jude. That's your assignment for tonight. One of the shortest books of the Bible. You can do it even if you're sleepy tonight. Read Jude. Jude was dealing with what we're dealing with now. Jude's problem is that the church is, as the church expands into the Greco-Roman world, inevitably there are people who are cultural Christians, people who are trying to bring in their culture into the church.
Jude says that they're blemishes at your love feast. But what does he say in verse 7? He talks about Sodom and Gomorrah as the example, people who've given themselves over to unnatural relationships. Earlier in verses 3 and 4, he talks about how these false teachers have stopped following the faith once and for all delivered to the saints. And he says what they've done is they've turned grace into lasciviousness. And that's exactly what we're seeing within church circles. But God is a loving God. And so they say, therefore, we can do these things. We should affirm these things. So that's the problem. Don made a really good comment in the book about the relationship with slavery to homosexuality on this issue. As you know, in the 19th century, the American church was divided in their interpretation of the Bible with respect to slavery. And those arguing for slavery were arguing for slavery because there was such pressure on their culture to interpret the text that way. We need slavery to survive economically. And so you can say, well, look, some people would want to say, look, you can read the text one way or the other. You can't. 1 Timothy chapter 1, verse 10 lists right next to homosexuality, it says, slave traders will not enter the kingdom of God. Well, if you cut it out slave trading, what are you going to do with slavery? And the same thing in Revelation chapter 18, verse 13. The horrors of the economic system of the Roman Empire are now being judged by God. And in a long list of things that will be judged, the last thing is mentioned, those who deal in human souls. The New Testament is not in favor of slavery in that sense. It's a complicated issue, but it's a point of culture and Christianity. And so what's happening is not just the issue of homosexuality, but we're living in a post-Christian culture in the West. We need to wake up, if we haven't by now, to the fact. And so we're back to where Jude was, dealing with the issue. But I want to close by mentioning 1 Corinthians 6:11, right? Verse 9 mentions homosexuals, two types of words for homosexuals. Chapter 6, verse 11 says, "But such were some of you, but you have been." And then he uses three words for transformation. You have been cleansed. You have been made holy. And you have been made righteous, as I would translate those words. You've been changed. And how have you been changed? By the power of Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit at work in your life. So this is the message we have. I just wrote a little booklet in South Africa to deal with some of these issues. We just published it, called The Pastoral Care of Sinners. We do need to, as evangelicals, deal with the sin and be clear on it, but we also need to, as evangelicals, be clear on how to deal with sin. And the pastoral care of sinners is really where the conversation needs to be for evangelicals today.
Yeah. Abram Davis. Thank you, Dr. Grahams, for picking up from there. That's actually where my question was going to come from, just from the cultural context, and also from historically just speaking how, from a redemptive hermeneutic, how some people have used that framework to really mention how homosexuality is very much equal to the civil rights movement. I'm just curious to hear your thoughts about that.
I can. I appreciate the African-American clergy who have been outspoken about how offensive that suggestion is. I appreciate their fortitude to stand up against our president, who has fostered the gay agenda during his presidency. And however you feel about him, this is going to be one of his huge legacies, like it or not. And if you remember the way he justified it, he cited Jesus. And that's right out of the gay Christian playbook. You ought to be able to love who you want to love. You know? And I would say there's really no connection at all. And as a black preacher friend once told me, describing that, he said, I had nothing to do with the color of my skin, and I am just entirely offended by any such suggestion. I don't know what more to say about that. You know, it's has been tied to the women's issue too, and kind of the theme of liberation theology. John McNeil, the patriarch of the homosexual movement, as early as the 70s and into the 80s, was beginning to talk about this march through history, and he believed that homonormativity is where culture is going. And this is what God, the Holy Spirit, is doing. I mean, it's a death wish. But yet, this is where the logic of that trajectory takes you when you get away from the basic Christian premise that's laid down in the Judeo-Christian worldview in the early chapters of Genesis in terms of the way we are made male and female in his image. And it really does come down to this. And so, there, as we've all seen, there's a real logic to this. So we've moved from the gay issue now to the transgender issue. They are inseparably connected. Because if gender doesn't matter for sexual relationships, then nor should any question related to gender. We can choose to create our own reality. In terms of our witness, and I think you would all know this, but just to, you know, state the obvious, one of the things that I want to encourage you to do is we have an opportunity to be for a witness to the Lord in a very volatile context. We don't need to apologize for our Christian viewpoint. I mean, this is what we all signed on for. I mean, every one of us in here that's made a commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ, we've said, I don't live for me anymore, I live for you. I don't have a copy of the Bible. But if I did, I'd hold it over my head. I live under God's Word, and that's a commitment that I made, and why should you expect me to do anything else? As a Christian, and we can loving and gracefully share that. But we live in a time where people want to think, well, I can make the Bible say what is meaningful to me. But as Christians, we've made that commitment. So we don't need to apologize for holding to a biblical sexual ethic. We've been doing it, well, as Rollin likes to say, for 3,500 years. Talk about the time of Moses. There's a consistent biblical ethic related to sexuality, and we've not changed. This is part of our commitment to be followers of Christ, and all of our brethren that have gone before us have made the same commitment, and there's no compelling reason for us to change. Humanity's not changed, God's Word has not changed, and the texts are just really clear what God would have us to do in the midst of this.
I'll add something, because this is an important issue, and it's an issue we need to get right, not only on the issue of homosexuality, but on the assessment of our culture. We live in a culture in which a certain kind of ethic makes sense to us, and we have to scratch our heads as to why it might be wrong. Every culture has to do that, and they have different pressures on them in terms of understanding things. Our understanding and our Western culture is that the primary virtue is liberty. And that goes right back to that's the American story. Freedom of worship, Puritans. Freedom from the oppressive King George III, who's looking more and more attractive to me these days. freedom in the civil right, freedom from slavery. Freedom of women to vote, freedom in contraception, control of your body, which ultimately in 73 becomes also freedom of the woman to choose abortion. But the civil rights sits right in there. Continuation of freedoms for non-white racists, let's say, but particularly American blacks. The civil rights movement trying to get further ahead of the problems that were already back there in the 1800s. And now we've got the issues of various issues of homosexuality, which are progressing now to the issue of gender. And so we interpret all of these issues from the through the lens of our Western culture's value of freedom. Freedom's the thing. We have some related values, equality and freedom. Tolerance was a value that we had in the 90s. We no longer have tolerance in our culture, although people still think we do, but we don't. We've moved to a tribalism now. It's my tribe's rights over your tribe's rights. In other words, Christians are being persecuted and not tolerated. So liberty is the key. So therefore, things like the civil rights movement are connected to things like homosexuality. We're only looking at things through this single value of liberty. In antiquity, they had four cardinal virtues, and they didn't include liberty. So the Greek world was looking at it through a completely different lens. Liberty was not their way of looking at the world. We need to realize we're looking at the world a certain way, and we need to help people in conversations to realize you're looking at the world through this lens. Now, just to give an example, Paul also was talking about freedom, and he had to draw a line. He said, freedom is good. Remember Galatians chapter 5, freedom, that's good. But what's he talking about there? He's talking about freedom from Jewish holy days, freedom from circumcision, food laws, sacrifices. That goes beyond just Galatians, but the early church was saying, we have freedom from those Old Testament laws. But then they drew a line and they said, but we are affirming the sexual ethics of the Old Testament. So not everything is going to be interpreted through the value of freedom. And that's what we get in Paul. And that's what we need to work out today. Freedom is becoming a problematic value in our society as people are exploring, how can we apply this further and further? But now what do we do about Islam? Our culture is beginning to ask questions of, where's the limit to this? They're not savvy enough yet in the public square to realize that this interpretation is too weak to hold ethics. Ethics is far more thick than this single value of freedom. We have to understand it in relationship to other values. And as Christians, we have to understand it in relationship to the authoritative Word of God.
If I get low in my voice, just help me to get it back up. I'm a retired pediatrician, and I come at it, and have come at this from a medical aspect. And I've followed it through focus on the family over many years, where James Dobson was accused of Matthew Shepard's death, and he got so angry with Katie Couric in the morning show that if Dobson had not talked about homosexuality and Pat Robertson and so forth, then the boy wouldn't have been killed. Well, Dobson started a gender department, of which I knew those people, and I was involved with the Exodus program. But go back to 1972, when the American Psychiatric Association was having their annual meeting, and a group took over the afternoon session and preached changing the nomenclature of the disease book, where it was a disease at that point, and the next year they took it out. That was a historic. 1973 is when they did that. They also had the Roe versus Wade at the same time. Now, look at the American Psychological Association and the American Psychiatric Association. The American Psychological Association has become very actively involved with this. And actually, they had a resolution never passed but put up in the American Psychological Association probably a good 10, 12 years ago. And in that, they said it was okay to fondle little boys, men, older men fondling little boys, and it would teach them what the gadget, as mothers called it, the penis, the gadget, what it was and how to use it. That never passed to my knowledge. And then take it further to California and New Jersey when they passed resolutions to not allow anyone to counsel kids under 16, which in essence stopped any kind of discussion about boys and girls and gender confusion. It's too late to get into all of this, but I think that's an area where I've come through dealing with the homosexual ministry here under Exodus. And you all know kind of what's happened to Exodus, but it's coming back in different forms. So I just throw that out to you all. Did you get into any of that? And wouldn't have thought to what your title was that you would have, but that's there, and just so that people know that. And because the people advising the California legislature and the people advising the New Jersey legislature, predominantly people that were homosexual and predominantly psychologists. And this came from a fellow by the name of Joe Nicolosi, who was in the North group, which has changed to the Alliance now, which is really done some yeoman work in this whole issue from a medical, psychological standpoint.
I'd just say thank you for sharing that, Dr. Bright. We have some of that in our footnotes in the first chapter. It was one of those important rabbit trails that we could not go down in the book. There were so many, again, because we wanted to put the emphasis on including in the book all of these texts, because we wanted the Christian public to be able to see them. Most of you are not going to get to go to a library and dig out all these things, but this is part of us trying to bring these texts out of the closet, so to speak, and put them out there. But that is very important, and as most of you are aware, there are many Christian psychiatrists, psychologists, chief among them, Mark Yarhouse, who's one of my real heroes for his courage in writing, and so we certainly reference his work and some others. But I am neither a psychologist nor the son of a psychologist, and we just couldn't get into a lot of that for the purposes of our book. But thank you for mentioning that, and I'll encourage all of you to read some of that good stuff. And remember the name Mark Yarhouse. Some good stuff he has written.
We may have people come to our church who are homosexual couples who are married. How are we going to deal with it? This is a real problem in my mind. We can believe all we want about what the scripture says, but if people do choose to come to worship in our congregations, how are we going to receive them?
Ms. Snoddy, I can give you one anecdote from a presbyter minister I have great respect for, who's a pastor. He's going to remain nameless in here, but of a huge church in the greater Charlotte area. I'll leave it at that. And his congregation has really tried, to be open, and persons that are gay that come to worship, they're invited to be there and participate and to hear the gospel. But his experience, and he told me he's seen this repeatedly, once it becomes clear in many instances to them that the church really is very clear on this issue, that they hold to traditional Christian orthodoxy, that usually these persons will no longer show up. Part of that, takes care of itself, at least from that anecdotal evidence. The other thing is all of us work with people, likely, in the workplace. It could be any kind of business, gay persons, and at least the persons that I know that have been converted and have turned their back on that former way of life, either the Lord has given them grace to pursue heterosexual marriage, or they've made a commitment to be celibate, because that's just the way I honor Jesus, because I know what the Bible says, and what he says is more important than what I want to do anymore, which is at the essence of Christianity. Christianity is about self-denial. I think somebody named Jesus said something about that, which is antithetical to everything our culture stands for. It's self-aggrandizement, not self-denial. But Christianity's, my point, lest I get too far off on that, one-on-one, I think, is where we're going to have our great impact. And at least many of the testimonies from ex-homosexuals is just an individual Christian that loved them. And yes, they may have taken them to church with them, but just lovingly shared with them, accepted them for who they are, but yet has had opportunity to be clear with them about what God's word says, and there's something more for you, and Jesus loves you. So I think the individual thing, but I think local churches are going to have to ask those questions and come to a conclusion on that.
Part of the answer to that question will come from people whose specialty is in pastoral ministry. And but in relation to biblical texts and the church understood through the eyes of the Cooley Center, the beginning of our the foundations of our faith, I'd say this: we could call them three graces that the church offers. One grace is the grace of church discipline. Now that's not what you apply to someone visiting a church, but someone who's trying to continue in the church. Church discipline is a grace. In 1 Corinthians 5, when Paul says, turn the person living with his father's mother over to Satan, because they cannot continue to do that in the church, that's a grace. Why? Because only if the person realizes that they're not part of the church is there any hope of eternal salvation to that person. As long as the church continues to accept them, say, oh, you know, we're just going to be an accepting group, why wouldn't God do that too? So it's a grace to turn them over to Satan. Now, the problem is, in our context, the person can go down the street to another church that's not going to have that view. Whereas in Corinth, there was no other option. So when the person was put out of the church, the person knew that the person was no longer part of the church. So the difficulty we have in applying that is quite great. I would say, though, it's still a grace to offer that to people who are continuing to try to connect to the church, but say, but I'm going to continue to do this, whatever the sin. But then another grace is forgiving grace. And then a third grace is transforming grace. And there's too much lacking in the literature that I read in biblical interpretation and theology that doesn't talk enough about the transforming grace of God. Kind of like, you know, you've got that problem, but you just stay celibate. I believe in God's power in a greater way than that. People will struggle with all kinds of sins, but we mustn't just say all we have to offer you is forgiveness. We have also the transforming power of God and the Holy Spirit to offer you. So I think those are three things to say in that regard.
I touched a little bit on something I was trying to put towards, just a question about, we have a good friend of ours that has keeps coming back to their experience versus, the conversation is a lot of times experience versus like going straight to scripture as an authority. And something that we didn't really know how to talk to them about was when they feel like they've seen fruit from a monogamous gay relationship, covenant relationship, and I'm kind of wondering what you would say about covenant between two peoples and how, what you would say about any of that.
Let me just be real direct, and then I'm going to unpack this. So y'all just grab the table in front of you and hold on. Under no circumstances is sodomy sanctified in the sight of a holy God. Now just think about that. Under no circumstances is sodomy ever sanctified in the sight of a holy God. Roland and I would argue based upon our textual study, the Old Testament teaches this clearly, the New Testament teaches it, the church fathers teach it, the Protestant reformers teach it, and only enlightened modern people have decided that everyone else are fools but us. That kind of relationship can be honoring to God. That sounds very harsh, but there are a lot of very direct language in the scriptures about this kind of homosexual activity, and so that is a part of the agenda that's being pushed now. Well, what about loving monogamous, same-sex relationships? I'm going to say something else very direct. In my mind, that's the moral equivalent of saying, well, as long as I go to the same prostitute every time, it must be sanctified. You may find that very offensive for me to even say that, but I don't know scripturally how we can ever say that in the sight of God, sexual contacts outside of male-female marriage, which we see pictured for us from the book of Genesis and through the rest of the 66 books, is God's revealed will. And we're either, pretend this is my Bible again, we're either living under the word or we're not. So back to Rollins' point, it's a matter of biblical authority. And I think the church is going to have some real challenges, loving people that are in those situations. But our God is powerful. The gospel is powerful. And even in those situations, there can be life transformation. So it's, again, seems like that is drawing a very hard line. But I don't see how you can read Romans chapter 1 or the Levitical Holiness Code, the teaching of the church fathers, in any other way. And there's really no new light. As part of what we've tried, there's no new light which would compel us to change historic Christian orthodoxy on this. There really is no new light at all. And so it's a matter of if we're going to be obedient or not.
I think it's helpful to think about a natural sin in this regard. The argument that we're dealing with is whether we can make something that's an unnatural sin a natural and accepted practice. Scripture does talk about unnatural sins. One of them is one that's derived, and that would be mistreatment of creation. We're supposed to take a role of oversight of creation in Genesis 1. But three are more dealt with more often. Another one is idolatry, not giving worship to the Creator, but something we've made. And that's a regular problem through Scripture. Homosexuality is another unnatural sin. Adultery is not the same. It's a natural sin. But homosexuality is an unnatural sin. And the fourth one that comes to mind is bestiality. So you might ask, I suggest this to people. If an argument sounds compelling to you about homosexuality, See if it works the same way with bestiality. Substitute bestiality and see how far that goes. Would you go to a wedding of someone who's marrying his dog? You know, so this is a good check. Another unnatural sin. Just on that point, sometimes you may have heard someone say, oh, there are only, sometimes people list six or seven, it's depending on how you count, passages that deal with homosexuality. Well, that's really a bad way to do theology, is to count texts. You know, if we get eight, then we'll be there. There are three texts that deal with bestiality. Half the texts compared to homosexuality. Are we going to say bestiality is all right? The other thing on that point, by the way, is that we have numerous texts that use general terms for sexual sins. If homosexuality is wrong, then all those general texts also are including homosexuality. The Bible has a lot to say about that particular sin. One thing, though, to note in 1 Corinthians 5 is that having dealt with the problem of someone in the church being accepted in a relationship with his father's mother, Paul says by the end of the chapter, but don't judge those outside the church, otherwise we'd have to leave the world. So our attitude in the church, which is a discipline that is an offer of grace to people, is different from turning to the world and trying to castigate them. We're not supposed to do that. One thing we need to do is to say, of course they're sinful. They don't have Christ. They don't have the revelation that we have. They don't have the empowering work of the Holy Spirit that we have. And it's an offer to them, though. They're not excluded from that. And so that's how the church can be winsome in this, as well as holding to a high standard. Looks like, despite my not having a watch, we are going to conclude tonight.
Yeah, this is a very difficult topic, and I'm sure there's probably more questions. So Dr. Fordson and Dr. Grams will be signing books here at the table here shortly. And so if you have questions, you can speak with them at that time. Just a couple of things I want to share with you before we close. One date is February the 23rd. That is our annual Cooley Lecture Series. Our topic will be Called by God in Challenging Times, and we'll be focusing on the lessons from the lives of Noah, Abraham, and Nehemiah. Our two speakers will be Dr. Carol Kaminsky and Dr. Tom Petter from our South Hamilton campus. I encourage you to come out and be a part of that. And secondly, just to keep track of what the Cooley Center is doing, we have a website. Go to the Gordon-Conwell homepage, go under Resources, Center for Early Christianity, and you can find all kind of resources, events that we have coming up, news items. We have research pages to help you if you're doing research into topics of early Christianity. We even have a church resources page if you want to offer academic resources for your church. So be sure to check that out. And so I encourage you to keep up with what the Cooley Center is doing. Let's close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we are dealing with a very difficult topic in our culture. And oftentimes it's confusing, even though we know the truth, because we are dealing with people who have eternal souls. And we certainly want to show them compassion and love. But part of love is also telling the truth. As one counselor said, showing tough love. Help us to know how to do that. In our own humanness, we can't do it. But through the power of the Holy Spirit living within us, we can be the witnesses, the salt and the light that we're called to be in these difficult times. Help us to never be afraid. And as Dr. Fortson said, help us to never apologize. Help us to always to stand for your truth and to be the witnesses you've called us to be. Thank you for this group that has come out tonight. Thank you for the truth that's been shared with us. Now help us to live out that truth, as James would say, not to be hearers only, but doers of your word. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.